And we're on in 3, 2, 1.
Welcome back to another Boxscore Geek Show. I'm your host, Dre Alvarez, and this week we'll be discussing a lot of stuff. I didn't get my script up in front of me, Brian, so I'm just going to keep stalling until I do. But that being said, as I mentioned, I'm your host, Dre Alvarez, a.k.a. Nerd Numbers. The show, as always, is produced by our own voice of God, Brian Foster. And this week, we've got co-host back again, Andrew. This makes multiple weeks where you've actually scheduled this correct. Might be a regular thing, but Andrew Sutton as co-host. So say what's up, Andrew, and then we'll get going.
How y'all doing, man?
And all of I'm gonna have to work. Pre-show, I'm going to have to start, like, doing rehearsal, promos and stuff. Dave Barry.
Lock me up something.
And yourself, you three all fall in this category. If I throw, I'm like, say hi, and you're like, hey, what's all right. So let's get going. I actually wrote a couple articles this week, so we're going to talk those. We'll see where that takes us. Brian's got some fun topics, including Houston's offense, the fact that the MIT Sloan Analytics Conference is on, and then, of course, some comments in the comment section about position adjustment. This will be fun. Then we might have a time for an I told you so moment. So let's start with two of my pieces. These should actually go pretty quick because I think they were fairly straightforward in how I wrote them. And even the couple of comments that responded to them, I don't think really provided much new. Maybe I'm being rude. Not saying they're a bad comment. Commenters, you're awesome people. I'm just saying, you know, there are pieces that are very open-ended and lots of places to go. And there are pieces that you write and there's not much else to go. So the first one I called Thinking Outside of the Draft Lottery, which incidentally got me a like from Mark Cuban on Twitter, which first time in forever, so that's always fun. But all I brought up, all that happened is I was looking over the draft lottery. Of course, I've been hearing a lot of this next draft is so stocked, this next draft is so big. And I obviously knowing that we love Rudy Gobert and DeAndre Jordan, and then, of course, Jimmy Butler, I went, it's interesting how much of the top of the NBA was not picked in the draft lottery. And when I broke it down, arbitrary cutoff, but 10 wins produced, which in any given NBA season is like our litmus test for a star. We'll likely get a couple more names added to this list by the end of the season, which incidentally will include some more not first rounders, like Hassan Whiteside is on the cusp of making this anyway. In terms of elite players in the NBA right now, it's players with 10 plus wins produced. All of these players have a points over par. Reminder, that's if you played an average team versus another average team, how much you'd expect to outscore them in a full 48 minutes. All of these players are basically plus 5 points or better about. Kyle Lowry and Otto Porter are 4.8 points over par per 48. But regardless, half of the top elite players in the NBA right now, and just to stress, I know this is the biggest run-on sentence ever. If Grammarly were analyzing me, they'd be yelling at me for how much I've run on. But if we looked at the elite players in the NBA right now, and elite's a very finite list, right? They're only, you know, there are only 150 starters in the NBA. So the top 12 players in the NBA, it's elite. It's always going to be elite. But half of those players, which is 12 right now, weren't picked in the draft lottery. And in fact, you know, DeAndre Jordan was picked in the second round. Jimmy Butler was the last pick in the first round. Just pointing out the same thing, broken record time, Andrew. You obviously jumped into the comments against a few of the people that responded against me. But getting a top draft pick does not guarantee you a star. There are lots of players that don't require tanking for you to draft. And then of the players that are star caliber players that were top draft picks, and by the way, the only two of them that were number one picks are Dwight Howard, LeBron James, and both of those were ages ago, right? LeBron James was 2003, and Dwight Howard was 2002. They were back-to-back,
right? 2005.
So it was 05 draft. So it was 05. So maybe I'm off. I thought they were back-to-back drafts because I know LeBron was the...
Was it 04? Was it 04 draft?
It might be the 04 draft 05 season. So sorry, listeners, it's going to be poor. I'll look it up. But no, you know, the only two number one picks that, you know, made this list were both picked, you know, over a decade ago, first off. And both the note we'll make is they were both high school players. And it was the 04 draft 05 season. So the only number one picks that are on this list were over a decade ago, both high school players. And then a bunch of the top three, you know, this kind of elite list that everybody tries to go for. You got to tank for a top three pick. Most of them aren't even the same team anymore. You know, when it comes down to it, James Harden, Kevin Durant fled the coup. So is Dwight Howard. LeBron James, as I mentioned, doesn't count as a Cavalier because he left for the Heat and came back. So really only Otto Porter and Russell Westbrook count as a top five draft pick that, you know, helped their team out.
It's surprising that people get selected to play for bad teams and then, shocker, they leave eventually.
Yeah, and I mean, even people – so one of the comments, Cedric and I went back and forth a few times, and he mentioned that, yeah, well, of these six players, though, note that a bunch of them took their teams to the finals. Well, first off, it's worth noting, James Harden, Kevin Durant, Russell Westbrook combined for one finals, and then it fell apart. So that's the rough one, right? Three of the and top
– the thing with that statement is, did they do that on their rookie contracts? If it was the second contract, it's different than the first contract.
I think – what you can essentially say for a player is, if they are an elite player, the way you get them is you get 5 years guaranteed. You get 4 years of the rookie contract. You get qualifying offer on their restricted free agency. And you will probably get their first 7 years, because if they're a star player that wants to get paid and still have bird rights, this is what Melo did in Denver, for instance. They will usually give their team 3 years to a max deal, which is what teams will kind of throw out. Now, it is worth noting the CBA has changed even more, where they're making it harder and harder for players to leave without leaving a lot of money on the table. But what's interesting, you know, you look at Dwight Howard as an example. Dwight Howard left money on the table to leave Orlando because he wanted another team. And even the same with Los Angeles, right? He left Los Angeles. And even with the Thunder as an example, the Thunder imploded because they got all these great young players and then they didn't want to pay for all of them. So I just find that amusing, too, that the model everybody's chasing is the Thunder. They're chasing the draft three stars on a team. All three get good at about the same time and you have a franchise team. And the like only two cases in NBA history where that's happened, I would say this and the Orlando Magic back in the day with
Shaq
Penny
and
Hardaway.
Penny. Yeah.
Which, by the way, that was first off, like what was 1 in 100, right? The second pick that they got, they were like a 40-win team with Shaq, I think just missed the playoffs, and then they lucked it into the number one pick. They weren't supposed to get it. And then not only that, fun behind-the-scenes story, we always tout ESPN 30 for 30. Sorry, I'm hogging the mic so much, Andrew. But we always tout ESPN 30 for 30. There's a great one on Shaq and Penny, and basically what happened is Shaq was filming the movie Blue Chips with Penny Hardaway. I can't believe Chris Webber. Chris Webber was like the de facto. Everybody knows he's the number one pick, the star player on the Fab Five that shocked the world by going to the NCAA finals. Everybody knows that Chris Webber is going number one. Shaq's on the set with Penny Hardaway, goes back and tells his GM, you got to pick up Penny Hardaway. He's Magic Johnson-esque. And they actually do. And not only that, they trade for Penny Hardaway with Chris Webber. And also I think get two or three first round picks. So that's like one of the rarest situations in NBA history. These are the only two cases that the tank model, I'll put in quotes, worked. And in both cases, it imploded after the team refused to re-sign a star player. James Harden, currently the league MVP, according to our numbers, we think he is like a shoo-in to win it at this point. And he was let go over, as we've discussed in past.
I don't think he's a shoo-in to win it. I think Westbrook's going to win it because of the whole triple-double thing.
I think there is good. Actually, one thing I haven't looked at, so we might jump to. Yeah, we'll just jump to the next piece because I also read up about Russell Westbrook. Fantastic transition. The one caveat I'll give for Russell Westbrook winning the MVP, and I do think triple double is enough to put him over the edge, is I do think the Thunder have to get to at least 50 wins. They're on pace for that.
I still think people are fascinated with the triple double thing. Because for the longest, people thought LeBron was going to be the one to do it. And now what Russell is doing it. And the team is playing is better than expected because they thought when Durant left that they were just going to be horrible.
Yeah, I think – well, I mean, I agree. I've said that narrative too. I mean, that was essentially the Steve Nash winning the MVP when Amari Stoudemire went down injured. I could be wrong, and I will be shocked. Like, I'll be pleasantly shocked, oddly. If Russell Westbrook wins the MVP on a team with less than 50 wins, I will be happy because for the longest time for so many of these awards, it has been a contender. I think I brought that up in my MVP post where I talked about viable candidates for the MVP, and I did list, for what it's worth, both Harden and Westbrook. But what I said is, since it's been moved over to the voters, the writers, it's been a top three team. The MVP has come from a top three team. And that, and even the Suns, I thought the Suns with Steve Nash might be different. No, that's still the case. Top three seed has always won MVP. So if that changes, I will be pleasantly surprised and happy. I still think it's Harden's.
Well, that's the narrative, right, Dre? Is there's the writers are thinking to themselves, well, maybe these players are equally good, or maybe even Westbrook is playing slightly better this year. I'm not saying I or we agree with that, but just the writers. But then they'll say, oh, but the Rockets, look at how well they're playing this year because Harden switched to point guard. Harden's having a great year. I think they will buy into that team success narrative.
I think the writers will like the Westbrook narrative more because of what Durant did by going to Golden State.
Oh, that's a good point.
It is worth noting that that narrative, the star leaving to another team, that's what got Derrick Rose the award, and arguably that's what got Steve Nash's second MVP. But the other, just to follow up, other narratives they love, the Houston Rockets finished last season 41-41. Barring something, they've already surpassed that. They're at 43-19. They are probably going to, provided health, you know, that's the, we'll talk to Durant a bit. Provided health, they're probably going to crack 55. That's another thing writers love. So we will see if writers love the narrative of Harden takes on an increased responsibility role, loses a star. Don't forget they lost Dwight Howard. Loses a star and pulls his team ahead. Or if they like the Westbrook, also loses a star, puts up insane numbers. I'm voting on Harden, but I'll be pleasantly happy if I'm wrong. And don't forget the last part about your Westbrook point, though, Andrew, is he does have to maintain it. He does have to keep that triple-double up. He's at it after 60. Is he going to be at it after 80?
I saw something on, I think, ESPN Stats and Info. They said he had, like, an 80% chance of, like, completing the triple-double for the rest of the season.
I don't
have any clue how they came up with that probability, but
that's what's rough is some models I have faith in and trust in and have studied, and some I haven't. And I have found the percentage numbers, and I'm gonna have to hit ourselves at this. Like the first 2 years of the Boxscore Geeks, we did preseason predictions. We based on some models that Arturo made, and we put like confidence intervals around odds to win the division, odds to win this, and it was so obvious by the end of the season that either we had the most unlucky season ever or the model was wrong, right? There is no way. When we talk like things like confidence intervals, by the way, I'll get a chance to throw some shade. Kevin Pelton in a discussion on the article I posted on O'Brien about the Mason Plumlee trade, I let it go after the first couple back and forth because it's not worth living in the comment. But what I would say is, he made a comment about confidence intervals on net rating with per 100 possessions. And he said that, and he said it was basically 7 points, plus or minus seven, or with a standard deviation of like seven. And I looked at that and went, if that's true, then the Golden State Warriors' first three games of the season shouldn't be possible. So just a point when you're talking percentage. I've seen lots of people throw percentages around, models around. And I'm not saying it's wrong, but I'm saying if I haven't checked the math, I get skeptical because I've seen even ourselves, even the Boxscore Geeks. This is, one of my things that I've done as editor where I've rallied really hard against kind of getting into that mindset that I bash so much. It's really easy to make a model, throw out a percentage or a confidence interval, and then it turns out you just did it wrong.
Yeah, but, my reaction when I saw it was like, oh, that's neat.
Yeah. But then also to that point, this did blow me away because the two things I did not realize. First off, I didn't realize Westbrook was under 36 minutes a game this season. It's a very good thing for the modern NBA that teams have clued in on. It is really important to rest your stars and not overplay them, and that a loss or two in the regular season is definitely worth that player being healthy for the playoffs, for their career, etc. So Westbrook is playing under 35 minutes a game, and this is becoming rare and rare for stars to play the insane minutes. I think Brian on a past show we mentioned, Michael Jordan played over 40 minutes a game three seasons in a row when he was young. And so to that point, Oscar Robertson in his triple-double season played 44 minutes a game, and we've talked this before. I brought up one of my favorite pieces that I wrote, which is called What Happened to All the Possessions? And then additionally, I'm going to have to get the article in front of me, Brian, sorry, because I don't want to get the link wrong. I want to give a shout out to a fantastic link we got to, and I just want to get the site right. So NBAMetrics.com, which uses net points. I love this. They did a pace of the NBA game, and they sent this link along to me. And so you look at the true shots per game, and you just look at the 60s when Oscar Robertson got that triple-double. The average NBA team got 30 more possessions than the current team do. So basically, Robertson, and I gave some back of the napkin math, like I said, basically he got like 40 more possessions to get that triple double. So we can dispute if Westbrook should be doing other stuff, if he should be deferring more. I mean, his assist to turnover ratio is good, but with his true shooting percentage, which is above average for a point guard, but should he be passing the ball more, whatever, irrespective of that, it is impressive that he is on the cusp of doing this. And it's impressive that the only other time in NBA history, the metaphor I gave, if we were looking at the baseball home run record, is if someone broke Babe Ruth's home run record, but it took them 250 games. So that's the situation we're in.
And I'll just add to your shout-out, Dre. Oh, go ahead, Andrew.
I was going to say, not only is the minute aspect, but the competition aspect. Because when in the 60s, the league was a lot smaller, and then the dispersion of talent was different.
No international players yet.
I left that out of the article because it already got longer. I didn't want to go off too on a tangent. But yeah, there were only 9 teams in the NBA in the 60s. No real international players. Obviously, there were no Soviet bloc players. There was no free agency. In fact, Oscar Robertson is a huge reason that there is free agency in the NBA. So there was no free agency. So, you know, once the Celtics picked up 4 of the best players in the league, it's over. The rest of the league isn't getting us. So, yeah, to your point on Westbrook, everything is impressive. I got some comments that said air to air is different. There's a lot to say about it. All I'm saying is if he does this, it's impressive. And by the way, this is one of those things I mock. I call it a Brian Burke stat, where people note the impressiveness of something. It's impressive that Kobe played for, 19, 20 seasons, but that's not necessarily valuable. I will agree that it's impressive if Russell Westbrook averages a triple-double. It may not necessarily be valuable, but it is worth noting. We currently have him as one of those elite players in the NBA. He's a top, he's a top 10 player, top 7, top 8. And he's going to pass Durant now that Durant's out. So, he'll probably finish the season top 5 in the NBA in terms of wins. Yeah, our numbers. So he is valuable and impressive, and that's our favorite type of player. That's the Steph Curry last season, Brian. The most three-pointers in a single season. That's the type of player we like.
Yeah, and I have to say I was laughing really hard a few minutes ago when you guys were talking about maybe Westbrook won't get to the triple-double by the end of the season. I can see some writers saying, 9.7 rebounds per game. I'm voting for Harden. The hell with Westbrook. It's like, no, just that, the difference between, 9 and 10 is not that much, but we still pulled up the triple-double as being sacred.
What is fascinating, by the way, I looked up a triple-double per 48 minutes, and what is remarkable is that is still a fairly rare feat. And it has happened, like Magic Johnson, by the way, periodically did that. But the players, James Harden, Russell Westbrook, and LeBron James have done it recently. So that, too, was kind of a thing that didn't happen. It has happened recently. So, yeah, I don't think anybody's going to be surprised when we say James Harden, LeBron James, and Russell Westbrook are freaking impressive with their versatility as players.
And one more thing, Dre, just to add to your shout-out, it was Pete Soris or Cerise, who is at Pete Cerise, is who sent us those NBAMetrics.com links on Twitter. And not only did he send us the chart of pace across eras, and I'm showing it right now, and yeah, the 60s was really pretty fast. He also sent us this chart they did on shooting efficiency across NBA history, which we talked about in the past. And yeah, up until, I guess the 76ers in the early 80s started dominating. And then, of course, the Lakers, no one could really play offense at all in the NBA. So great charts they sent us.
Random anecdote that was actually a fantastic transition, Brian, but I'm going to take us off on an anecdote first and get us back. Listen, Allen Iverson, when he won the MVP in 2001, which was an egregious MVP and arguably the worst MVP in NBA history, although I put Derrick Rose's 2011 MVP. Yeah. Derrick Rose's MVP as worse because that LeBron James was that's LeBron. That's peak LeBron. That would be like Michael Jordan not winning the MVP in 1988. That's egregious. Allen Iverson's also
him getting getting the MVP over Dwight and LeBron is crazy.
Oh, that's a good point too. So, but that being said, Allen Iverson that year, his shooting efficiency was league average. That's the point. And that's what I always said. When people are like, someone has to take the shots. I'm like, if you can't as a team replace average, if you can't replace 20 shots at league average, you're doing something wrong. But what I noticed is Allen Iverson's true shooting percentage the year he won the MVP this season, at least earlier in the year, it might have changed since, was like bottom two in the NBA. So the NBA as a whole, like the worst team in the NBA now shoots like as good as Allen Iverson was in 2001. But when Allen Iverson was doing that in 2001, it was like the league average. So yes, the league is also, yeah, players are getting better at shooting. And we had this brief discussion about a Nylon Calculus piece, Brian, if like stars were getting better. And our point was the league is getting better. Players are getting better. Stars relative to league average aren't as good as they were in basically the 80s when, you know, Magic Johnson, Dennis Rodman, Michael Jordan, Larry Bird were just dominating the competition. So, but the NBA in general is a much better place. That piece I mentioned, Brian, the what the heck happened to the possessions, that was one of my points, that people are nostalgic for the past and don't forget that past NBA players sucked. Sorry.
You're right.
All right. Nothing for me there. Okay, let's talk the Houston offense. So just an impressive point, and I know this happened. They got over 50. They've averaged over 53 pointers a game in three of their last four games. And I believe, I don't know if you have this link on here. You added a bunch of links, Brian. Mm-hmm. I apologize. I've not read through all of them, so I might have you go through them or sure. Andrew discuss them. But I know that is an explicit strategy from Mike D'Antoni. Mike D'Antoni said he wants them to average over 50 threes a game. And what I actually said is, I don't care what happens in the playoffs. And this might be a little different now with Durant out. It's so tragic. I said, I just want a 6 or 7 game NBA playoff series between the Rockets and the Warriors where the average number of threes taken a game is 100 or more. That's all I want, NBA gods. Anything else, I don't care this season. Just give me that. Although that kind of might require Durant coming back healthy. So, yeah. We've talked this before. You know, it's worth noting we gave Daryl Morey a shirt that says Morey Ball, which is rebounds and threes. Another name you've given it, Brian, which is one of my favorites, is Bop the Clown. Because if you look at what that heat chart looks like, if a player does that, it's a big red circle around layups, a big red line, like a smiley face. In fact, can you do this real quick, Brian? If you bring up James Harden's shot chart at Basketball Reference right now, I think it's a Bop the Clown one. Am I mistaken?
Well, let's see. I've got Basketball Reference open to this game log here. Let's do it live. We've got the Rockets.
If you go to Rockets and then you go shooting 2016-2017.
Oh, we can just go last game here. How about that? Where is Harden? Oh, no, we actually have to. I'm not very good at Basketball Reference. So why don't you just keep going, Dre, and we'll circle back to this once I find it.
I was going to say, it looks like Basketball Reference might have gotten rid of their. They used to have a little heat map, basically.
Yeah.
So if you go to James Harden and look at shooting 2017, they used to have like a little heat map that would come up that was kind of cool, although it looks like they just do shot chart now, which is a shame. Basketball Reference, I love the site. I will say this season they tried to add some Ajax-y stuff, so like a lot of JavaScript loads dynamically instead of statically. They've changed up a lot of stuff where things are hidden under submenus. I hate to be mean. It is one of those where they made the site worse this season, which is unfortunate. So sorry, Brian. No heat chart, I guess. But yeah, he is definitely a Bop the Clown, which looks like a smiley face if you do a heat chart of their shooting. I don't have anything else. Do you have anything else to add on the Rockets offense, Andrew?
No, same stuff we've been saying from his Phoenix days. Try to do it in L.A., but the personnel wasn't there. And then Kobe, I think Kobe was kind of stubborn to it.
Well, I forget when Steve.
And then he had a brief stint in New York where they had like probably their best win total in the last, 8 years?
Oh, and by the way, this is a perfect opportunity to eat some crow on air, Andrew, because at the start of the season, I was right but wrong. So I get to be an obnoxious politician here. Start of the season, the Rockets in the offseason, they let Dwight walk or Dwight walks, you know, but I got to believe they could have resigned him if they wanted him. So Dwight walks, they pick up Ryan Anderson and Eric Gordon. And they spend a ton of money on these two players. By the way, imagine if the Rockets had spent their money on like anything, like if they picked up Whiteside. Oh my God. So anyway, the Rockets spent all of this money on Ryan Anderson and Eric Gordon. And were like, this is freaking stupid. What are they doing? And I basically said, I'm not buying that the Rockets are a contender this year. And the start of the season, your argument was D'Antoni's a good coach. And this works for, you know, he is like the perfect coach for James Harden. And, you know, he did the wise thing. He says, why don't I just have the ball in James Harden's hand? Why don't I copy Steph Curry, right? Steph Curry starts with the ball, can shoot threes. James Harden, why don't I just start him with the ball? He can shoot threes. It looks like he helped revitalize Trevor Ariza because Trevor Ariza kind of had an off year the year after and came back. And so, you know, I can't guarantee full credit, but the reason this team is running so hot, it's not any of the offseason moves. It's that the great players on this team that had really high ceilings before under D'Antoni have kind of gone back to that. And he has definitely changed the offensive scheme to something we say. You know, it's funny. We talk about coaches and not impacting player performance. And I think one of the reasons is coaches don't really tend to change schemes or systems. They just kind of play random lineup. You know, they tinker with lineups, Andrew. We've talked this before.
I think his free-flowing style and his, like, his personality, it just gives the players more confidence. And so they're more willing to – they don't feel pressure to make the shot. Therefore, they make shots. So there's not pressure to make the shot.
That's actually 100% perfect. We've talked about how players think themselves out of stuff and, you know, worry and force it. A lot of players force it. And I think that is, you know, I can guarantee it's important. But, yeah, basically the Rockets this season have an amazing offense, and D'Antoni probably at least deserves a little credit and some other players. So beginning of the season, I was really skeptical of this team, but I did say I'd turn around. You said you were really high at him, and, you know, you were right. You're definitely right. It looks like D'Antoni, James Harden at point guard has really clicked, and, you know, the fact they picked up Lou Williams for nothing now and they're going for 53s a game. Again, Andrew, we'll see who ends up being right at the end of the season.
And then free agency-wise, there's got to be a long list of players who want to play for Houston right now. Because
what if they bring back Terrence Ross? That'd be a good
he's
one.
Gonna make, he's gonna make so many players so much money. Like Lou Williams, he's gonna probably, if he has an opt out, player option, he's gonna opt out. His price is going up. Lou Williams' price is going way up.
Let's give the Lakers some credit. The Lakers really helped Lou Williams' value, and it was, I gotta give, sorry for another audible, Brian. We'll see how much time we take. I got to give Magic Johnson a little credit. I wasn't on the show. I know. I wasn't on the show where Patrick and Brian were discussing that essentially we can't really grade Magic Johnson until we've seen a full offseason with him. And that even my point was when Magic Johnson came in and his first move was to trade away Lou Williams, I was like, well, I'm not a fan of this move. It doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. And he was really saying, I'm not going to trade around our high draft picks. Well, a point on that is that, you know, they pointed out, actually giving his high draft picks confidence and trying to make their free market value higher might be a good move. So we don't know what he's going to do yet. But what I will say is the Lakers before Magic Johnson were like ignoring their star rookies. And to be fair, we kind of said their star rookies were overvalued. But it is, you know, it is interesting that the Lakers have basically helped out a lot of veterans. They helped out Meta World Peace, Kobe Bryant, now Lou Williams, as opposed to trying to develop their stars. And so, yeah, Lou Williams got helped out by the Lakers kind of being silly there. Maybe Magic's going the right direction. You're saying, even if they're not the future, I got to at least treat them like they're the future because they're my assets. We'll see what happens there. I think I'm glad you and I are on the same page, though, Andrew, that we're both a little skeptical that the Lakers, that anything's going to change.
I'm going to give Magic like I give everyone else a couple seasons. Like we did with Hinkie. We gave Hinkie 3 seasons, and after 3 seasons, if there's no playoff appearance, he got to go.
I will say on Hinkie, the one pseudo out I'll give, because this was very atypical, is unlike other general managers, Hinkie was going into the biggest cap free agency of all time with some huge names. And so it's possible. Now, I know, by the way, I want to stress, I am traditionally negative on Hinkie. I'll say that I liked his draft picks. I liked him risking there. I liked him getting rid of the bad players. But as a general manager, you have to sign veterans. You have to sign veterans. And he was, this is one of those players where, like, he's like Klay Thompson. He's really good at shooting threes and doesn't really do anything else. And it's really hard to only be good at one thing and still be a star player in the NBA. But so with that in mind, it's possible Hinkie was a year behind where he wanted to be because he was waiting for that draft. He just didn't quite make it to it.
But that was the problem, waiting for the draft.
I agree.
He was selling lottery tickets.
No, Dre, are you saying he might have succeeded with his current strategy if he'd kept going?
Saying if he'd had, if in this last offseason, if he'd gotten 2 big-name free agents and then done a good draft. I agree. So what I'm saying is, if that was his plan and it happened, and by the way, there were some players that, you know, went for nothing.
I don't think there were agents that were clearing. They were telling players to steer away from the Philly. So I don't think they were. I don't think a lot of teams and players and agents wanted to help Hinkie succeed.
you're likely right. So I mean, and also it's if you have a 4-year plan as a general manager, and part of that 4-year plan is contingent on stars liking you. This is one of the things I hate, Brent. I'm so sorry, I've got so far off script.
That's okay. Like, I'll talk about Houston's offense when you're ready.
I'm like Nick Young, just taking a half court shot with 18 minutes or 18 seconds left of the shot clock. The last part. So I think, yeah, if you got a 4-year plan and it's contingent on free agents, and this is something that always bugged me. People are like, if you want to attract a star player, here's what you need. If you want to attract a star player, here's what you need. And the fact of the matter is, since there is such a limited crop of star players and their wants and desires are different, you can't know that Michael Jordan, you know, LeBron James. LeBron James is probably the only marquee star player that wants to play in Cleveland because he's from Ohio and kind of feels he owes them a title. There's like Kevin Durant wouldn't have gone back to Cleveland. Yeah. So it's really hard to try and guess what
pure happenstance that he's from Cleveland. So therefore he feels indebted to his home place.
Exactly. Well, from Akron, not the same. But anyway, yeah. And then I was going to say on that is it's really hard to predict what superstars are going to want. So if Hinkie's saying, I'm going to have a shot at these 5 superstars this offseason, and as you're saying, Andrew, if by the time that offseason rolls around, all of them have been told by their agents, this guy screwed us in the draft. We don't, you know, Porzingis didn't work out for him notoriously. Says, this guy screwed us over in the draft. We don't want you going there. Dwight, you can't sign with, the 76ers because if you sign, I'm not going to give him any other clients. You know, that could have happened, so we don't know. So, sorry. Last point, this was an audible. This was an email from Chris Yeh, who was interested in top 3 draft picks, interestingly enough, given that he's a Laker fan. I know the answer to my question, but this is interesting. Currently, I'm going to mess up this name, Brian. The top pick is estimated to be Markel Fultz. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Who is a freshman, Washington, who is slated currently to be the number 1 pick. Now, however, my opinion to Chris is you want the number 2 pick in this draft because Lonzo Ball, who outside of having an awesome name, is such a better player on everything. The only difference, and I just looked this up to figure it out, Markel Fultz averages 8.3 more points per game than Lonzo Ball. But Lonzo Ball's efficiency, assist to turnover ratio, his height, he plays for a winning, you know, something Arturo has brought up before is, in college, if you play for a winning squad, your numbers might actually be better than you think. Because unlike the NBA, good college squads can load up. They can overload talent. You know, places like
Kentucky, especially.
Kentucky, Kansas. Duke. Yeah, Kentucky. The Blue Bloods of college.
I think was David Lee at Florida?
Yes.
Yeah. But they weren't traditionally a basketball powerhouse until later on.
When David Lee was with them.
Okay, yeah.
They were overloaded.
Al Horford, they had other players like that.
Joakim Noah, man.
How can I forget about him?
Al Horford and Joakim Noah is almost an NBA team on its own. That's ridiculous. So, yeah, basically, if you're on a good team, your numbers might be better than if you're, you know, Markel Fultz is on a horrible team that incidentally did lose to UCLA, although I believe Markel didn't play. So when it all comes down to it, the reason I'm calling this audible, Brian, because we're talking the Lakers and helping is, I am just amazed that, you know, I figured I'd throw it to you, Andrew, because you know college better than me and I don't really follow it. I got to believe that in this draft, Lonzo Ball should go first and not Markel Fultz, but I could be wrong.
I agree. I think he should go number 1. And before I talk about Lonzo a little bit, I want to squeeze in something that I did today. I was on Basketball Reference and I went back to LeBron's draft year. And I compiled the SRS for the 30 franchises, and most teams tend to hover around 50%. Therefore, the 50% draft rate, and you get outliers like Charlotte's the worst. They're so far away from 50%, and you have San Antonio at the other spectrum where they had like almost a six or seven SRS rating. Then the next closest one was a 3. So you have outliers, but for most teams, they tend to fall on a coin flip, basically. So if you give teams a coin flip at the draft, and most of those teams are going to, with the culture around the draft and how they have this messiah complex with incoming rookies and thinking they're going to save the franchise, then you get this problem of people tend to think that you build a championship team through the draft. And I think that's probably why I said something to ALS, and that's basically his sentiment was basically everybody's sentiment.
And by the way, it is worth noting that AIS makes, and I believe that's right, Brian. I'll copy and paste again because like I think the fonts are font
okay.
makes.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But he has made some of the most clever comments in the comment section. I love it. But I agree. They're the most fascinating thing about sports to me, and I fall under this too. You notice me? I'm chasing the Russell Westbrook impressive triple double, which, as you noted, Brian, if he makes 9.7, I'm not going to be as impressed. The voters aren't going to be impressed. That's just an arbitrary cutoff. But you know, I admit I'm falling for it. But every sports fan I've noticed, even the analytics savvy ones, end up falling for these, you know, these narratives, these things, and that is what makes sports fascinating.
Yeah, and then on the case with Lonzo Ball, yeah, I think he should go number one. But there's also another freshman that's probably super underrated right now. He plays for Gonzaga, Zach Collins. He's a big man. He can play out. He can stretch. He can rebound. He can play defense, block shots. And I don't think he's gonna come out this year because he just doesn't have the minutes. But he should be someone to watch out for in the future.
He should. By the way, it is worth noting he is on Draft Express's top 100 board. He is listed 23rd. So there are two reasons I think he should come out. One, the Nuggets are notoriously good at drafting, and I think they'll be near that range. So you know that would be amazing. First off, second off, you know we pointed out that every year you wait in college just hurts your stock. Now it's possible, yeah. You know. You make it to the Final Four the next year, your points go up by like 8, it helps. But, you know, you hurt your draft stock by getting older. And not only that, you're not making money, right? Even at draft pick 23, I think Zach Collins would be on par to make, what, $2 to $3 million yeah. a season. There is no way that his long-term earning potential. By the way, well, this is a...
Forget about the draft stock. It's the earning potential because you can potentially injure yourself and therefore you have no NBA career.
Exactly. And I mean, well, what's I've noticed this is I have a master's degree and the stats basically say this. A college degree helps you out. Lots of stuff on that. We'll get out. But at least in traditional senses, before college tuitions have skyrocketed, and I'm not sure how true that'll be in 20 years if things keep up the trend they're going, but trends tend to change. College career is definitely worth it. It increases your earning potential. Now, we can talk about degrees. There are certainly degrees where that isn't true.
Yeah.
If you get a master's degree, it tends to increase your earning potential from a college degree. It's a 2-year degree. That makes you look better on resumes. A PhD, though, lowers your earning potential. And it's possible that there's selection bias. You know, you go for certain things. But one of the reasons is that it hurts your basically spending 4 years in academia instead of spending 4 years earning money, getting promotions, et cetera, hurts your stock. So we're saying that to Zach Collins. It's like going for a PhD if you go back to school.
Go get your money.
Yeah, you might increase your earning potential, but go get your money. Sorry, Brian, we got so far off track there. Is there anything you wanted to say before I get to the "we told you so"?
Okay, I'll talk briefly about Houston's offense. So
I can't believe you remember that. That's impressive. Okay, keep going.
Yeah, I mean, the stuff on the script's what I want to talk about. So there was let's bring this article back up here. So there was a shot chart that blew up on social media last week. Which was, let's bring it up here. Last Thursday, with the Pelicans versus the Rockets, they won by, you know, 20 points, 129-99. And I'm showing the shot chart right now. It was linked by Rockets_insider on Twitter. And there's only 3 mid-range shots on this shot chart for the game. Every other shot was at the rim or behind the 3-point arc. And they actually made 2 out of the 3 mid-range shots. So this was one of those. And I went to Basketball Reference and I tried to cobble something together for, you know, how good is the Rockets offense this season? Well, they're taking a lot of threes lately. They've taken 50 or more in the last 4 games. And the other one, they took 45, which is, you know, pretty close. And they even took 58 in a 142-130 win over Patrick's Timberwolves. So they're shooting a ton of threes right now. And so when all this talk about floor stretch in the past, and this even ties into some of the people in the comments and position adjustments, is that and this also goes back to Ari Caroline's 3-part series on floor stretch, which is really interesting. What I remember, I didn't get a chance to refresh myself on it today, but I remember his big conclusion being, and I think Patrick and maybe you two have written about this as well, is instead of trying to say, well, let's get smaller power forwards to stretch the floor, let's, you know, do other stuff, let's take more mid-range jumpers. Let's just take more threes, period, wherever they're coming from, right? And then we've thought for a while that teams,
was essentially that the shooting guard is this perimeter position, and most teams suck at it. Most misusing the shooting guard, because they're having exactly what you're saying. Instead of having these shooting guards take tons of threes, they're having to take mid-range shots. So, you know, the conclusion essentially is, of the five positions of the NBA, teams are mucking it up. And the small ball strategy, as you're mentioning, was to try and turn a power forward into a perimeter player. The real strategy is just get a shooting guard that can shoot three-pointers.
Yeah, that's right. So, you know, we've been talking a lot about, and everyone has, about how there's so many more three-pointers. But we've also been, I think, one of the biggest groups of people saying, well, there still isn't enough, right? They need to take more. Well, the Rockets are finally doing it. And we're going to see where this goes. Maybe they can push it up higher. Maybe they can take 60.
I want to get a shout out. I'll include the link. He tweeted at himself, and I forget because it's years ago. Arturo submitted a paper years ago to Sloan that talks about floor spacing and his strategy that teams are not maximizing threes.
Yes.
Now, just for due diligence, because I've been the person that whacks everything, you know, I can agree that there are ways papers are written that need polish, whatever, to get accepted to certain places. And by the way, Sloan, it's less the polish. I've noticed a lot of people that just have the right name get in. But anyway, don't want to get too far down that rabbit hole. So I'm going to say, I'm not necessarily saying Sloan was wrong for rejecting it, but I'm saying they were wrong for not having Arturo in some capacity to talk about the strategy, because Arturo basically did lay out teams are not optimally doing shot selection. They need to take more threes. And so it is worth noting Sloan is put on by MIT. And at that Sloan conference, Arturo and I did give Daryl Morey a Morey ball shirt. So it's possible Morey and D'Antoni read that paper. I'm not saying that. Sure. But yeah, so, and I'll give that as a final note in basketball analytics. You're always underpaid.
So Arturo is getting sent a ring this year when the Rockets win the championship, you're saying. He deserves one.
That was a notorious part of the whole Moneyball story, the book Baseball and Moneyball. The guy that came up with DIPS, Defense Independent Pitching Statistics, who was actually hired by the Red Sox, felt he was snubbed because his work was underused. But it's worth noting, he came up with a model. He put it on the internet for free. The Oakland A's read it. And so it's like he's going, why did they give me more credit? Why did they give me a ring? Well, there aren't baseball players that play for a team for free and then leave and later go, why didn't you give me money? You could have. That never happens.
that's a good point.
What I took from Ari's work on floor stretch on Wages of Wins site was that a team has thresholds for each production, like each statistical production metric. So you have to have a certain amount of rebounds, points, blocks, steals, and stuff like that. Differential from your team, the opponent. So when you place a stretch for who can shoot probably 36 or 37% from three, but he only averages 8 rebounds per 48, there's an opportunity cost there. So to offset that, you probably want to play some super rebounders at guard just to outweigh that. But instead of doing that, just play a big that can rebound and then just get some shooters.
Yeah, A lot of the small ball strategies and the people that are put up as examples of see this can work involve like really rare player. Like Sean Marion and Draymond Green are not given, in my opinion, the credit they deserve. Though it's worth noting, I think Sean Marion had like a 97 in NBA 2K8 because he's amazing. But these are rare players. Like that's the point. You know what I mean? When your solution is to say, just get Michael Jordan on your team, just get LeBron James, right? That's what's the strategy for making it to the finals? Just get LeBron James on your team. That strategy's worked 6, maybe 7 years now. Like, that's not useful. It's not useful to say get a super rare player that's a one in a generation player. So,
but if I have to point this out about, I was talking to a guy about LeBron earlier this week. Have to point out he's been playing on these, so that does factor in his appearances in the finals. Does factor in a little bit?
Oh, absolutely. But I mean, be an Eastern, those two factors. Be an Eastern team and get LeBron James. If you're the Nuggets, how does that help you? Like, there's nothing you can do with that. Actually, Brian, I'm going to do one more jump since we're already kind of in there. Just to give a shout out, the Sloan Analytics Conference is going on right now. As you noted, there are three. There were only two last year, but there are three NBA papers. I have not reviewed any of them. I do know that David Barry was a peer reviewer, and I believe two of these papers he did sign off on, give a check mark to. I'll verify that with him. We will probably do something similar to what we did last year, which is I went over the papers and, you know, as I mentioned, due diligence, peer reviewed them, you know, went through them line by line, didn't kind of just do a holistic look and then give my two cents, because as we've been mentioning, that's what we hate. Not going to do any of that now. And then, of course, just ahead of time, this is being kind of a little flippant and rude. I'm just not super thrilled about the state of advanced analytics. So I will be pleasantly surprised if these exceed my expectations. So I'm hoping that happens. I'm hoping things have changed. I will say Sloan, looking at like the speakers list and the size, it's turning into like Comic-Con. It's gotten really, really huge. There's so many speakers, so many things. One last kind of just flippant note. Again, another flippant. I keep reusing the word flippant. Shane Battier, who is director of basketball of player development and analytics for the Miami Heat, is listed on the Sloan website as former NBA player. Now, provided he did probably get that promotion after he agreed to speak there, but come on, Sloan. If you're an analytics conference, former NBA player for a director of analytics, come on. All right, Brian. We should probably be able to make just about an hour. Let's talk the position adjustment. Andrew, thank you for actually jumping into the comments, because this is, I've had this discussion a million times. And let me get some thoughts out. So for those that don't know, the wins produced formula, unlike pretty much every other freaking advanced basketball stat, which is impressive to me because the wins above replacement formula in baseball does this. The wins produced formula compares position by position. Now, there are slight modifications to it. One we made this year is we compare point guards to point guards, perimeter players, that's shooting guards, and small forwards to shooting guards and small forwards, and then bigs to bigs, power forwards, and centers to power forwards and centers. Now, you can split it up a little more granular, which we've done in the past. There are other changes you might, there are other small tweaks you might be able to make to the type of positions, but regardless, that's what we do. And just as a side note, we use the Yahoo API. I've been getting less and less happy with how they distinguish players, so we're probably going to update the feed that we use for positions for the players, because we also have an algorithm that adjusts. And so if the initial feed isn't great, so there's some players where I think we could tweak their positions a little, but in general, it's a pretty good algorithm for that. And our only point is, in basketball, players have different responsibilities. And you were talking opportunity cost, Andrew. Essentially, the way basketball works is you got five players, you're going to put them on the court, and each of those players are going to say, we need you to play at least this good. If you play better than that, gravy. And in basketball, you know, the positions basically are players that are close to the hoop. Because of the rules, you really only get two of these. Players that play on the perimeter, these are the guards. And then, you know, they kind of have the quarterback strategy. The point guard typically gets the ball. That's all we're saying, is that you want all of these players to be good, and we're comparing them position by position, which is nothing new. Now, the issue with this that I find irks a lot of people is, if a player is played out of position, you can have a talented player that our number is going to say is below average. But what I want to stress is what we are saying is, we are being very economist about this. The production or wins or points or whatever unit of measure you want to do, that is what that player in that game or that season contributed to their team based on how the team decided to use them. Now, as I mentioned before, this is a descriptive stat. It's telling you what happened. So as an example, Steph Curry, he missed how many? He missed like 10, his first 10 threes against the 76ers a few games ago, right?
Yeah.
He went 0 for 11 for the game, I think.
Yeah.
Ah, nice. I knew you'd remember, Brian. Steph Curry goes 0 for 11. If we read the box score and said Steph Curry had a horrible night from three-point shooting, we are not saying Steph Curry is a bad three-point shooter. We are not saying we don't expect Steph Curry to shoot 40% from three the next game. We are telling you what happened. When we tell you Dirk Nowitzki, as a power forward for the Dallas Mavericks in 2014, had a below-average season, we are not telling you that Dirk Nowitzki, if he were played as a small forward for another team, would have had an above average season. We're telling you what happened. And I understand that there's a bit of give and take here to this model, because there is some amount of player agency that is removed from this. It's how the team decided to play them. It's how the coach decided to coach them. But regardless, that is what the metric is. There are lots of tools you can use in your arsenal to do stats. The wins produced metric is a descriptive statistic telling you the production the player gave to the team at the position the team decided to play them at. Full stop. If you want to do other stuff, if you want to do draft models, or not draft models, like free agency models that look at future years, We are behind that. We've done that where you will add things such as age, coach, team, injury, you know, age curve, right? All of previous seasons. There's all the stuff you can add. One of the things that bugs me is that people kind of want a metric that tells you how good a player is, how good they will be, and how good they were. And that doesn't really exist, and it shouldn't. So when people are bringing up the position question, I think this is what they're doing. They're bristling because we are saying this player is below average. And they're saying, but they'd be above average this position, or they'll be above average in the future, or
the
they
2K
were above,
problem.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing up the analytics trope, which I brought up. The 2K problem is people think if they had control of the franchise or player, the player would be better, which we don't disagree with.
Instead of looking at the actual thing that's happening.
That is what is important. We are just telling you what happened. And I understand if you don't like that.
All I was going to say is my favorite example is Paul George from the last few seasons. And we've talked about him a lot, right? And you guys know what I'm going to say here, but I'll go through it real fast just for everyone else. 2 years ago, Paul George played power forward. Hopefully I'm getting this right. He played small forward for the Pacers and had a great season and, you know, was a top small forward. And everyone's like, great. Then last year, he was power forward a lot more of the year. And people were quick to point out in the comments, well, his raw production at power forward and small forward were similar both seasons. So why are we saying he sucks now when we were saying he was good before?
And just to verify, like Basketball Reference, in 2014-15, they think that he played 99% of his time as a small forward. In 2015-2016, they think he played 40% of his time as power forward or center. So yeah, we're not the only ones saying this. This is what happened.
Oh, awesome. Thanks for having my back there, Dre. But the point is, of course, if you played him small forward, it would have been a better season for him. But that's not what happened. He got crushed by power forwards. He got out-rebounded by players much bigger than him. And he got all the shots blocked and all that. So, I mean, yeah, it sucks for Paul George, but that's actually what happened.
But being much better than a small forward to being a little above average as a big. And then there are another few considerations that the Pacers have been playing him a lot of minutes. Don't forget he had a freak injury in the Olympics. So, you know, Paul George is this young prospect that as a small forward looks great as a young small forward. He has injury. He gets played out of position and he's not as good anymore. People are saying, how can you say Paul George isn't one of the top small forwards in the league? And our answer is he might be, but on the Pacers with how they're playing him right now, he is an average.
Or he was in the past.
He was, yeah.
And he may be in the future.
Yeah.
But right now with his age, with his injury, with how he's being played, he is an average small. He is an average, not small forward. He's an average forward for the Pacers. And it's worth noting the same thing. Ari Caroline actually got in a little discussion on Twitter. The same thing happened with Omri Caspi. Omri Caspi's production stays the same, but they go from playing him as purely a small forward to being kind of a big, which is a bizarre maneuver with all the bigs that team freaking has. It's like, just play Willie Cauley-Stein and DeMarcus Cousins as a Twin Towers. Too late to do that now. But it's the same point. If a player is producing the exact same, but you upgrade their position, then it's actually hurting your team. And it's not the player's fault, but we're not trying to tell you if the player is smart. Like, there are metrics, you know, I would say things like shot selection, assist to turnover. There are lots of metrics if you want to judge a player's intelligence as a player that you could use. That's not the wins produced job, though. It's just to tell you, here's how they contributed to the team.
And because WP is a descriptor stat, it is that means it's a box score stat, and in some point differential factors into the metric. So that's why you compare positions, because theoretically the position would mean I'm comparing this point guard against an opponent who would be another point guard. So that's why you break it down in positions, because you're just comparing them to the opponent. You can't know who guarded this point guard, but generally you would just say, let's just compare this point guard to other point guards, because you don't really know who guarded the point guard.
But when you say point differential, it's perfect, because what you're saying is all five teams are constrained by this. You have to play five players. And the NBA game may change. That may happen. But it has not yet, by the way. I just want to stress that. The idea of having bigs and guards has not really changed at all in the NBA. So the thing is, all we're saying is all of these teams have these constraints. Given those constraints, here's how well they do. Here's how well, based on how well they did, here's how you distribute the responsibility. That is it. And we agree that actually part of the problem in our, not a problem, but part of the evaluation of a player It's how the team chose to use him. But we don't. The problem, you said descriptive stat, Andrew. We don't have a choice. We don't have a hypothetical world where James Harden played center and Trevor Ariza played point guard and Ryan Anderson played shooting guard. All we can tell you is James Harden at the point guard, Ryan Anderson at the stretch four with, you know, Clint Capella as center.
If you want an alternate reality, just go play 2K.
Let's clone Harden 1,000 times and have 1,000 different leagues and see what happens.
But wait, that's my favorite, the 5-on-5 argument. How would 5 Kobe's do against 5 Dennis Rodman's? It's such a stupid – sorry.
Yeah. And so we were talking about this about 5 or 10 minutes ago. I think you guys are kind of talking about Bricks42's comment, which is if you hold your opponent to 0 from 20 in the field and shoot 5 from 14 yourself, it's a bad game. And, yeah, it's hard to give individual credit for defense. And a big part of wins produced is that – stuff that's not in the box score and is not team defense maybe doesn't contribute as much as you think it does, right?
Well, what would happen there in that case, by the way, is the entire team, according to wins produced numbers, and this is something that I am very excited about, that there may be the stats.nba stuff may be able to start adding the ability to do individual defense, but I still think individual defense is just going to be it's just not going to be predictive year to year. You can't, I mean, for instance, right now, in the 76, you can go look at like stats.nba.com. You can look at contested shots by player and by distance. And like Joel Embiid is amazing. But I don't think you can guarantee Joel Embiid that guarantees he's amazing at defense, because it's going to require teammates that make sure he's not, you know, if you double team a player on offense to defense, right? If you get two players because some guy manages to slip by a screen or something, it doesn't matter how good a defender are you. If it's 2-on-1, you're not going to do well. So I still don't think it's as easy. But in the example Bricks gave, Brian, essentially the team defensive stat would be very good for the team and all of the players would suck otherwise. So they would that's what would end up happening there. And we agree that there are things for that. But I would also point out, this is what tends to happen, and I don't want to diss the commenters too much, because I do appreciate the feedback. And this is very, you know, I didn't really engage, mostly because I've seen it all before, but this isn't bad feedback in the thought experiment. It's just we've seen it before and it just still doesn't work for us.
I actually love all these comments, because as somebody that does not know as much about statistics and all the formulas as you guys, I am very educated by all this. So
I wouldn't even say I'm that. I just thought it was straightforward stuff.
Second worst then, Andrew. I'll be the worst.
Okay. If you just look at the explanation for the metric, it's just kind of straightforward. I just thought it was straightforward stuff.
I don't think I think you might be a robot. I think you just failed the Turing test, Andrew. You might be a robot. What I was going to say is these hypotheticals, they don't happen. This doesn't happen in the NBA. Like you may have a team that shoots poorly, but there's not a team that shoots under 30% and then another team that shoots 0%. It just doesn't happen. But anyway,
my last thing on this, guys, I had a question that maybe we can answer, maybe not. So the biggest complaint that I got kind of aggregated out of all these here was basically the idea, Love Deals Knicks posted this first, and Iceman kind of pointed some examples that we say being a three-point shooter is good, good value per shot, right? So when you stand at the three-point line, which is good, you get punished and you don't get as many rebounds, was their basic point from what I could tell. But I mean, that seems intuitive, but there's a lot of players, both bigs and smalls, that shoot a lot of threes and rebound together. And if that were true, everyone could do that, right? But it's not.
So to just follow up that point, the problem with that thought experiment is we taught the key word of the day, might name the show this, Brian, is opportunity cost. So what people miss out is if you've got a big that's near the hoop, something easy you can do, go to basketballreference.com and just do like, I think I think at one point, Brian, you had the seasons up and they're like miscellaneous stats at the bottom that have like scoring summaries. But so if you have a big near the hoop, the reality is some of these charts that got really popular, Kurt Goldsberry's shot charts that like are these brightly colored heat maps I was talking about. I was hoping you would get a Bop the Clown one for James Harden. But the way that they kind of go is they look at the league average at that location and then how much better or worse you are than the league average. And the reason I hate this is that the average, but the average, the autoplay ads on Basketball Reference, hate it. Sucks about it. If you look at an average shot from near the rim, 0 to 3 feet, it's going to be you know, if you score like 60% from 0 to 3 feet, you're going to look yellow on these heat charts. You're going to be like average. But if you score like 50% from mid-range, you're going to look great. You're going to look green. You're going to look above average. But shots at the rim, it's just much easier for them to go at a higher rate. So even if you're average at shots from the rim versus great at shots from mid-range, they're like the equal production to your team, basically. So with that in mind, if you have a big that's near the hoop that's more likely to get rebounds, that's what people brought up, you know, you're giving up rebound opportunities for 3 points. You're not just giving up rebound opportunities. You're giving up easy shots and easy putbacks. You know, Kurt Goldsberry also wrote a piece called The Kobe Assist that was arguing that, you know, a player like Kobe might be valuable. I thought it was bullshit, this argument that he made. Player like Kobe might be valuable because he takes a long shot that doesn't make it, but then a big like Pau Gasol or Dwight Howard gets an easy putback because if they get the rebound, it's like a guarantee to go in. Now, by the way, the fact that the conclusion from that is Kobe missing a shot might be valuable, not a player that can get an easy putback and put it back in might be valuable, was baffling to me. But that's just the basic point. The opportunity cost of your big not being close to the hoop is more than just them missing out on rebounds. It's them missing out on the easy, you know, we just said this, layups and threes. You know, replacing a mid-range shot with a three is a fantastic move. We love it. Replacing a layup with a three does not have as much upside as you would think. And then if you give the opportunity cost of missing out on an easy offensive rebound and put back, that's kind of what we're saying. So if you're going to be a player that makes that trade-off, which we've said Dirk Nowitzki does, you better be damn good at threes. And Dirk in his prime was. Dirk was able to make the trade-off. There are players like Draymond Green, like Dirk Nowitzki, who can make the trade-off of being more of a stretch than being more traditional. But if you're going to do that, you have to be darn good at it.
I wonder what a team would look like if it was, say, average from three, average at the rim, and didn't take, let's say, 5% of their shots for a total in a season, which is 5% with mid-range jumpers, and they took those at an average clip. What would that team project out to be win-wise? And I would say they would probably be a playoffs team.
If you give me a few more constraints, Andrew, this actually sounds like a fun post that we might have to put together. And by the way, same kind of note on that, Andrew, the SRS thing you did, that I like that segment, but it was way too short, and that's kind of on me. I've been hogging the mic. I've been Kobe in this podcast.
It's fine.
Send that along. We can maybe try and turn that into a post next week because that's too cool.
Okay.
All right.
You mean the theoretical Houston Rockets team?
Oh, it's the draft stuff, right?
Or the draft stuff.
But the SRS coin flip draft.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Okay. Let's see. Yeah, we got a little bit of time, Brian. I'll take it. Unless if either of you have to go, we don't have to, no, but I'll...
Fine. I got the Warriors game on pause. I'm going to see what happened once the show's over.
I'm going to do the I told you so.
Oh, and you want to look at... You were talking about shot charts. There's a site called AustinClemens.com.
He's great. He is great.
Yeah, he has good stuff.
Yeah, he's one of the... Nylon calculus can be hit or miss, especially when they hurt our feelings on Twitter, but he's one of the good ones. What I was going to say is we're at the I told you so section, and this is about Kevin Durant and Joel Embiid, and I'm not happy about either. We don't like injuries around here. But the reason I want to bring this up is the reason Joel Embiid is an I told you so is all we said is, look, there's injury concerns around this guy. Why is everybody forgetting those so quickly, and now he's out for the season? And I think we've all brought up the fact that, you know, the 76ers medical staff is starting to get questionable. I think people noted that Nerlens Noel had a different injury and then had the same injury that Joel Embiid has now that's keeping him out for the rest of the season. So we don't know what's going on there. And then also Durant's injury. Now a bunch of people are saying, you know, now it's Cleveland's title to win. Cleveland has to be the favorite, which I don't agree with. But the point being, people forget injuries so much in sports, it baffles me. Because they see a talented rookie and they go, this guy is the next Jordan. And you go, that means he has to be healthy for his career, and there's no guarantee of that. Or people see a dominant team like the Warriors, and say, you might as well tank because you're not beating the Warriors in the first round. And they forget, like, by the way, I think since getting rid of the shortened first round of the playoffs even, I think more number eight seeds have won. Like, the odds if you're a number eight seed of upseeding the number one seed in the playoffs exceeds like your odds that your top three draft pick turns into a star.
But losing as an eighth seed is better than being in the lottery. We've also thought that for a while.
Well, that, but I'm saying the logic people have about not wanting to be the eighth seed is you're not gonna beat the Spurs or the Warriors, so don't bother. You know, you're just gonna lose. You're gonna flame out in the first round. You can't be a contender, so you might as well just move on. And then like last year, don't forget Portland managed a lucky injury for Portland managed to make it so that they took down the Clippers. And then, you know, actually, they almost had two lucky. But that sounds mean to say it that way. They almost had two injuries. They almost took down two of the top seeds. They almost took down the Clippers and the Warriors. So people just forget this all the freaking time. And that's all. When I say I told you so, I just want to say, stop forgetting injuries. Stop forgetting that young players that look talented can go Grant Hill or Greg Oden or the best one, the probably the perfect, the poster child of this is.
And speaking of luck and bad luck and injuries, talk about bad luck and just players' productivity having an expiration date. You never know when that clock's going to stop.
But that's actually, and Brandon Roy is true on both, right? Brandon Roy has injuries, but he lasts six seasons. He looks great. And then suddenly his career is over. And this, and the same thing is true, right? Like LeBron James, when you talk the ticking clock, I don't think LeBron James is going to age out gracefully with how much wear and tear.
Interesting.
I think LeBron James, one day the wheels are just going to fall off.
I disagree. I think it's possible that he could just be finished, like physically incapable of playing. Like that happened to Patrick Willis in football. He was, you know, considered to be maybe the best middle linebacker in football. Just done. His career's over. He can't physically play anymore. Steve Nash, the same thing. He was like 40. He wanted to play seasons. He couldn't physically do it. That could happen, but LeBron has, if he is able to keep playing, he has so far to fall. His talents will have to erode so much before he's even an average player. I think he could play for a while. Maybe he can't block shots and transition like he used to, but he's still going to be able to rebound with good position, still pass the ball, still shoot threes.
And people assume he's just an athletic person. There's a lot of skill there. So even when the athletic ability diminishes, I still think he'll have some skill. He can still come off the bench off the bench, role player role on a championship team.
That's the Kobe problem, right? Like, does he want to?
Yeah.
Kobe could have been, I think, especially given that like that bounce where he like fixed up his knees and came back and was playing above average. We were like, what the hell is going on? I think if Kobe that season had instead of decided to be a starter playing 40 minutes a game, had said, I can be a 25-minute, I can be Andre Iguodala, come off the bench, be a fantastic role player, maybe even win finals MVP like Andre Iguodala. If he'd done that, that's an entirely different story. But no, he kept playing until the wheels came off. So I think we'll see what LeBron James does.
This is where I think players like reverence for Coach Pop is kind of like BS, because I think a lot of those guys, they say, oh, he's a great coach and this and that. But I don't think if 32-year-old Kobe was told, okay, Kobe, you have to come off the bench. I don't think he would take that nicely.
Yeah,
even from Pop, I don't think he would take it nicely.
I think, and we talked this like on the Alliance with Chris Yeh, who did inspire the draft talk we had. I do think that the best run teams do have some level of at least agreement among management and stars, and that is key. And the Kings, as soon as you have like all three heads, right? You have the players versus the coach versus the front office. That's when it's the pinnacle of dysfunction. So I think that the Spurs, and this has been something we've heard about them, that they target personality for players. They do the culture fit thing, which I've mentioned bristles me the wrong way. I don't care if a player is a jerk if they get me 20 wins, but the Spurs have kind of tried to make sure everybody's on the same page. And I think all of the credit goes to Pop for that. And I think it's very important, but I think you're right. I think that a lot of that, yeah, it's Manu Ginobili and Tim Duncan going, yeah, sure, I'll take a reduced role if it means I get to play another three seasons and get another shot at a title.
Aldridge is the litmus test for them, Dre, both as a coach and a GM, I think. If he keeps playing bad and finishes out the rest of the season, he's got two full bad seasons with them, maybe they'll think about moving him. And he's also a guy that maybe the attitude isn't good with him. There are rumors in Portland. Maybe he's just decided, I'm going to keep shooting mid-range jumpers.
There were rumors at the start of the season that it was already falling apart. You know, for instance, they pick up Deadman and Pau Gasol. So it's possible they tried to pick him up, thought they could change him, kind of did, which is what the numbers show last year. And then he said, screw this. This isn't what I want. I'm supposed to be getting my touches. I'm supposed to be getting my shots, whatever. But, you know, the good news is he's a star. You know, he's a trade chip. They can trade on. But I agree. He's a litmus test. We'll have to see what they do with him in the future.
So watch out, Sacramento.
What are they? Well, actually, no, they'd take Willie Cauley-Stein. Yeah, never mind. Sorry. We'll see if Sacramento has any pieces. They just keep giving away pieces for nothing. That was a lot of topics, Brian. The show notes are going to be, I'm debating if I'm even going to just do show notes or just say tune in, beyond what you have on the script. Anything else you want to say, Andrew, before we go to shout outs?
No, I'm good.
Yeah.
No, I'm good.
What about that too? Anyway, Brian, anything from you?
I'm good. Let's do the shout outs.
All right. Actually, I don't have a shout out, so I'm just going to cheat and do what I already did. NBAMetrics.com.
Yeah.
Fantastic site. Love it. I'm so glad somebody else picked up the ball and ran with the like net points, true shot stuff that I enjoy. I didn't even come up with it. Obviously, that's the true shooting math, but I love seeing that because I hate the number of metrics that are out there that don't do efficiency, et cetera. So NBAMetrics.com. Check out the site. Great one.
My shout out goes to Brian Burke. He had a piece that he wrote about Adrian Peterson not being worth the $18 million. We're running backs in general and their value, and it just reminded me about guards, and I went to look at Portland's cap situation and just started smiling because...
Are you saying CJ McCollum might not be worth the money?
Yeah. Him, Evan Turner, they got so much money in guard capital.
Jeez. All right, Brian, anything out of you?
Just when we thought they were on the, like, had a great future ahead of them, they just squashed it away by giving him all that money, $100 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do have a little bit more on the Rockets offense. There were some questions asked. All I'm saying is we're going to have the links in terms of what are they trying to accomplish. Morey has some comments with Bleacher Report about that on a specific strategy, and even some coaching stuff with D'Antoni and the pick and roll. We have a link there, too. So I'm curious what's going on with the Rockets offense and haven't been able to do as much research as I want yet. So anyone else out there, throw me them links. I'd love to read them.
All right. Sounds good. Well, that has been our show. If you found us not through the website, you can find us at boxscoregeeks.com. We have a live show every week at twitch.tv/. No numbers went late this week, but usually we try and go Tuesday or Wednesday at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I've been your host, Ray Alvarez, a.k.a. Nerd Numbers, co-host Andrew Sutton, who is on the internet. You don't have like handles that you want. Just look in comment sections on forums for Andrew Sutton. If you see one, that's probably him. Odd story though, Andrew, I did have somebody in grad school also named Andrew Sutton. I thought you might be him at first when you first started coming at Boxscore Geeks or Waves of Winds. Produced by Brian Foster, a.k.a. Boxscore Brian on the internets. Find us on iTunes and Stitcher. Subscribe, upvote. And if you miss the live show, you can find us on Channel Nerd Numbers on YouTube. That's been our show. We hope you have a great week, and we'll see you next time.